Hey there, students. Tom Richey here with Marco Learning. In this video, I'm going to give you an overview of Unit 7 in the AP European History course, which focuses on 19th century perspectives and political developments. So we're looking at nationalism, we're looking at new views in science, and we are looking at imperialism and global dominance by these modern European empires. First of all, we've discussed nationalism, beginning with the French Revolution, this whole idea of the loyalty to a nation, okay? This ideal that everyone is a part of this nation and that this nation is also rooted in some sort of liberal or participatory principle. Now, remember, what is going to make a nation, according to these 19th century theorists, is a common language. Okay, now, of course, there are other common elements of culture like religion and other shared experiences, but language really is going to be the biggest thing here that is going to unite people. And in the late 19th century, what we see are two places in particular, Italy and Germany, which are united at this time. Now, of course, Germany was the leftover of the Holy Roman Empire. And what we saw happen in the 18th century, we saw the rise of Austria and Prussia. And so now we see Austria and Prussia vying for dominance in what was formerly the Holy Roman Empire. At first, of course, Austria was on top with Metternich and the Congress of Vienna. But as the 19th century progressed, Prussia embraced the Industrial Revolution. And Otto von Bismarck put together this idea of unifying Germany under Prussian dominance. Now, not just based on nationalistic principles, but also on conservative principles and sprinkling in a little bit of liberalism and socialism in this process that Bismarck called Realpolitik, the politics of power rather than the politics of ideology. So he would ally himself with whatever group was necessary. And Bismarck's goal of unifying Germany eventually came to fruition through warfare, blood and iron, as he saw it. Now, Bismarck eventually was the architect of the alliance systems and everything that kind of led to World War I, although that wasn't his aim. But German unification is his greatest legacy. Italy experienced a similar unifying phenomenon in the late 19th century. Of course, ever since the Renaissance, Italy was divided into all of these different principalities and states. And by the 19th century, most of them were dominated by foreigners, dominated by the Bourbons in the south and the Austrians in the north. And of course, in central Italy, it was dominated by the papacy. After a failed attempt to unify Italy in the revolutions of 1848, Garibaldi teamed up with Cavour, who often is known as the Bismarck of the Italian unification movement, used a very realpolitik kind of focus here. And Italy, like Germany, was unified through a series of wars. So with Germany and Italy, you had the instance of people who shared a language being divided by political boundaries. And so these political boundaries were eventually erased. Of course, the political boundary between Germany and Austria stayed there, but Italy was united on the basis of language, just like Germany. Now, of course, as we get into World War I, we will see how nationalism has the opposite effect on a place like Austria-Hungary, where you've got 10 different ethnic groups that are sharing a political boundary, and that's going to have a much different result. The late 19th century also saw new movements in science, one going in a very rational direction, the other one embracing the irrational. Positivism was a philosophy that came of age during the late 19th century, and it's really all about looking at the world as it is, without any kind of regard for a systematic framework, that we observe what's there and we construct everything based on our observations. Now, the best example of positivism is Charles Darwin, who, of course, went and observed all of these finches in the Galapagos Islands and came to the conclusion that we were evolved from a process of evolution, that the subspecies and species that had been separated, that we have this evidence here. Now, of course, from the perspective of the positivist, it doesn't matter that this evidence that we have conflicts with traditional creation stories, such as the creation story in the Bible, that whatever's here and whatever we see, whatever evidence we have, this is what matters. That is the science of positivism. Now, Darwinism, just like the scientific revolution led to a revolutionizing of society during the Enlightenment, Darwinism also went hand in hand with the social philosophy of social Darwinism, which was really in a lot of cases an outgrowth of classical liberalism, that social Darwinism was a philosophy that emphasized the competition among human beings, which mirrored the competition among species that we see in nature. So just like you have natural selection and the survival of the fittest in nature, so you have it in human interactions. And of course, social Darwinists said that there should be as little government regulation as possible. Taxes should be low, because when government intervenes to protect the weak, then it's not just that the weak are better off. Everyone is worse off because they have tied the hands of the people who were advancing society. And this, of course, was a very prevalent philosophy in the late 19th century. Now, on the other side of science, we have relativism, which we see in people like Nietzsche, for example, where Nietzsche said that, look, objectivity, nothing's really objective, that everything is subjective, that there's not some sort of independent truth that exists, but truth is really what we make it. Now, Freud comes from this kind of relativist school, where Freud starts to get really mystical, getting into modern psychology and the interpretation of dreams. Now, from an Enlightenment perspective, when we talk about interpreting someone's dreams, that sounds like going back to witchcraft and stuff like that. But Freudian psychology is noting the subconscious, that there is something under human consciousness, whereas the rational, the Enlightenment way of looking at things is about thinking in terms of your conscious mind, your rational mind. But what Freud's seeing dealing with people who are experiencing the aftermath of childhood trauma and troubled relationships with their parents, Freud is seeing that there's something buried within that is coming out through dreams. And so this is something that, on one hand, you've got the positivists, which are all about using evidence and observation and a hyper-rationality, and then, of course, the relativists, who are taking things in a very different direction. And of course, World War I is going to have an effect on that thinking as well, as the rational world where science and technology are leading to universal human improvement, that is kind of going out the window when all of these technologies have been used to kill each other. Another thing that we want to note here is that even physics is changing. And so Einstein's theory of relativity, which is kind of combining some aspects of positivism and relativism, it is replacing Newtonian physics. Now, of course, we still learn Newtonian physics in schools because there's a lot of merit to it. But at the same time, that's not really the latest physics that people are using. And it's one of those things where I can't explain the theory of relativity. Newton's ideas are much easier to digest because they have a rational basis behind them. But remember, when we're going from a positivist approach, there doesn't have to be a rational basis behind it. The theory of relativity, it may or may not make sense to you, but you know what? They've done experiments and they've observed it, so therefore it must be true. The late 19th century also represented the high point of European global dominance, whether that is as a percentage of the demographic population of the world, economic dominance, and technological dominance. And this led Europeans to search for resources and looking in Africa, which had really, for the most part, been ignored before this, with the exception of the slave trade. But by this time, technology such as when we think about medicines such as quinine are making it possible for Europeans to go into Africa and not die of malaria. So we see how technology is making it possible for Europeans to go places where they had not gone before. And with these ideas of social Darwinism and the idea that their culture was more evolved, then Europeans are going in and for basically partitioning Africa. We want to remember the Berlin Conference. That's something that is always a good thing to bring in there, that the Berlin Conference was an attempt to try to organize the imperialism in Africa so that it wouldn't lead to Europeans fighting over it, that there would be some kind of order to this. And so the Second Industrial Revolution is allowing Europeans to do basically whatever it is they want in Africa and in Asia. And of course, that also came with the spread of European institutions as well. And just like with the old imperialism, now remember, this is the new imperialism. So we might be called upon to compare this with the old imperialism of the Age of Exploration. Similar to the first wave of imperialism, we also see an emphasis on spreading European culture and the Christian religion as well on these cultures that were largely seen as backward. Now, just because they were backward didn't mean that they weren't interesting. That Europeans also, in addition to sending out all of their manufactured goods for consumption in these colonized areas, they were bringing in exotic goods from these areas. So that's something that is very important to note, the increase in trade and creating markets for European goods, but also bringing all of these exotic goods to European buyers who are all of the sudden interested in what's going on in the world. We look at art movements such as Impressionism that show a decided Asian influence. So we start to see not only Europeans influencing the world, but the world is influencing Europe as a result of the new imperialism. So Unit 7 focuses largely on nationalism, advances in science, and the new imperialism of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Remember that during the late 19th century, both Italy and Germany were unified on the basis of language, that all of these borders between these Italian and German states were obliterated, and governments were set up that were national governments. So you really see the triumph of nationalism in Germany and Italy. Of course, there are these advances in science. Remember, we want to remember positivism, and we also want to remember relativism, this idea that we look based on observations and what's there, and then this other idea that maybe nothing's there, or maybe we just kind of imagined it, or maybe what's there is actually in our subconscious. Remember Darwinism particularly, and its outgrowth, social Darwinism. Then finally, we get to the age of European imperialism, and remember that this was caused largely by this technological gap created by the Second Industrial Revolution. And so Europeans who were technologically superior went out to the world and they wanted to increase their economic output. They wanted to have trade with all of these places. They wanted to take resources, and they wanted to, of course, spread their culture and to bring in the cultures of the world, which have become fascinating to them all of a sudden, especially with the expansion of the middle class at this time and a focus on leisure time and people who are able to afford works of art and art that emphasizes the natural and the mundane, like Impressionism, and even with a bit of an Asian flavor here now and then. And that wraps up Unit 7. It's always a pleasure.